Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, when temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you.
There are a lot of reasons why I don't like doing the lead, but one of the reasons is because when I get emotional, if I'm doing harmony, I can just move my mouth and nobody knows, but when I'm doing lead, I have to keep going. So 26 years ago today, my daddy went to heaven. And 3 years ago today, on the same day, 23 years later, Clay's dad went to heaven. And it's always been amazing to me that the Lord, that just felt like a little God wink the day he took Poppy home. And I said, that's amazing that we will always remember our dads on the same day, but even though I have to remind Clay every year. But we remember our dads on the same day. And when I think about this song and I think about my dad and the legacy of faith that he left behind, Clay has said many, many, many times. Are you wanting to say something?
On this same day,
Mark's birthday. Okay, well, remind me to do that right before. Okay, let's just go ahead and do that since you brought it up. Mark, you were supposed to stand there and call the sign that said, "Huh, don't forget, it's my birthday." Yeah. And I found out that Mark and I are the same age. And since we celebrated my birthday in October, you should remember that and know how old Mark is. All right, let's sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mark. Anyway, back to thank you for breaking that up so I don't cry. Anyway, so when I think about the goodness of God, and I think about the legacy that Daddy left for us, Clay has said many times over the years, I'll always believe that no matter how dysfunctional your family is, not that he really said that, but he did, no matter how dysfunctional your, functional your family is, the reason you all gel and stay together is because of the legacy of faith that your dad left behind, and that is the truth. And so when we sing this song, and I think about the first verse that says, all my days have been held in your hands. There's not one thing we've been through, not one minute of my 60 years that I've been through, that God was not holding me right there. And I'm so thankful for faith and legacy of faith. And that's my challenge to you parents and your grandparents. Leave a solid legacy of faith for your family. Because if you don't live it and leave it, who's going to? So thankful for the goodness of God. Y'all sing this with us.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Is it? it great to have a choir up there? Didn't Hal make a handsome thorn among all those roses? Just saying. Well, anyway, let's get back to prayer time. I don't think I put this verse up there. I just realized I was putting my headphone on, and I did not put this verse, but this was my verse for today, Psalm 121. It says, I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. I was out for a couple weeks, and I'm telling you what, I just miss it like crazy. It's my favorite hour, or hour and a half, or 3 hours a week. Just saying. Are you glad when they say, let us go to the house of the Lord? And we gather together. I love the silence. We gather together. And in this building, we could count the number of people are here, 60, 70, 80, 140, 287. And we can add that. Because the Father is present with us. So, Father, we come to you right now. We've offered to you praises through our song. And I've just offered to you a praise. I just quoted you from your word. Glad to be here, Father, in your presence. And as an offering, Father, of praise to you, we bring to you, Father. We bring to you the name. Names of the people who are in our lives, who are in desperate need of your help. Father, as we call out these names to you, just like Peter said, as an act, Father, we cast these names to you. We cast these cares on you, knowing that you are in this place and your ears are hearing our prayers. Wow. Father, I pray for Beckham and Peyton, aren't here out sick today. Father, we just continue to pray for Samuel. Pray for miracle after miracle in his life, Lord, that you will jaw drop all of us and the doctors. Please, oh God, do that. Father, for Cindy Varner's mother who is at home now, Lord, would you raise her up? Father, for Darla, would you continue to raise her up? She was at our home on Thursday night for soul.
She's here. She's here.
Praise the Lord.
Darla, were they glad when they said to you, it's time to go to the house of the Lord? You missed being here, don't you? Thank you, Father. For Jenny Moore Hodges, this week she went to Houston, MD Anderson, and had a PET scan. And my head scratched when I read this. Her PET scans were clear. Amen. That means that the cancer hasn't spread any farther and it's holding it at bay. Wow. Father, over these last few weeks, thank you for hearing these names that we called out to you. And now, in your presence, while you are listening to us, we, your people, offer these other names in prayer. Father, behind every one of these names, there's a story. Behind many of these names, there's an maybe not a great happy story right now. But Father, we trust that this is a story that you are in the middle of writing. We pray that every one of these stories, Father, because this story isn't over, it isn't yet good yet. It may not be good, but it's not finished yet. In quietness in your presence today, we would ask you, Father, that you would quickly hear our prayers and come to our aid. Father, we're going to sing another song and then we're going to look in your word. And we've been talking to you and singing to you, and I would ask this morning that for every person here, starting with this guy, starting with me, Father, that while you are here in our presence, Father, I would ask that you would speak to us and that we would hear. I pray in Jesus' name.
Lay down your shame.
great looking group of kids that is headed out to Kids 247. Thank you, Jill and Aubrey. Just say a little prayer for you while you're there. Teresa Jean, extra prayer for Teresa Jean while she does music this morning for all those kids. You know, sometimes it just hits you. And while I was just praying there, considering that we're in the presence of God, and now I'm going to stand up and I'm going to open God's word, and God's here in our presence. And so, man, you can say a little prayer for me if you want to. That probably feels a little bit intimidating, you know, that the author of the word came. I'm talking from his book. It's his book, and I get an opportunity to talk from it this morning. He's here, so I ask you to pray for me. I always start with, since last week, I just want you to see the church in motion. Hope and I were coming down our driveway this morning, headed to church, and there came a trailer, a tractor trailer, and there were three chartered vehicles on it. And that turned on the interstate, we turned on the interstate, and we're able to go around it. And I don't know if you heard this last night, but on Interstate 26, just above our house, there were five people that were killed last night. This was us from behind. The next one is as we came up beside it. Hope got some pictures of it. All of them were black. They were just completely charred. There was one more. They said they had not released the names yet. Apparently, a commercial truck was going west and hit a car, and it drove him across the median. He went across the cable median, hit another car, headed eastbound head on, and all four people in that car were killed. Five in that car that were killed. Nobody in the first car that hit the commercial vehicle was killed, and the driver of the commercial vehicle, I think, was treated and released, or maybe he was hospitalized. Kind of sobering. I hadn't planned on showing that since last week, but man, that kind of stuff happens in the world, does it not? On a couple of very much lighter notes, we had salt in our home on Thursday night. Thank you to Bonnie for playing. We played, you can see it there maybe in the corner, we played human bingo. It was really great. I got that picture, and then I've got the Golden Girls sitting on the couch. Just saying. Friday night, we packed up and we went to Winter Jam. And you see three pictures full of kids there. Well, not just kids, some old kids like me and Hope and Bonnie, just saying. And then the next one, I think I've got the video there. On the right-hand side was some of our kids just standing up praising. On the left-hand side, just hit the button there, Chris.
In a big old world, you can't make a big difference. But I want you to know something. When your one little light shines amongst all these thousands of lights, you become a city on a hill.
And everybody was holding up their light. They had all the rest of the lights out. And everybody was holding up their little flashlight on their cell phone. And it lit the place up. It was a great challenge. That challenge, I think, was by Lecrae. Lecrae is a rap musician, artist, singer. And when we got in the car, I said to the guys that were riding with us, I said, too long, too short, or just right? And they said, too long. It was about 4 hours long. And they said, after Lecrae, we could have gone home. And Hope and I were thinking, really? The rap was your favorite, but to each his own, so there you go. That's right. Last week I talked about there being one standard for all of us, and that standard is the standard of holiness. We looked at James chapter 3, verse 1, and it says, not many should become teachers. If you're thinking about becoming a teacher, be a little bit reluctant or hesitant to do it, and here's the reason why. Don't become any teachers, my brothers, because you know that once you make that decision to stand up and teach God's word, you're going to be held to accountable, not only to the people that you're teaching, but also by the Lord himself. That was last week. Before we traverse down this path any farther in James 1, I want to offer you some word pictures. I ask you to stay with me. By the way, there's some different ways to learn. One of the ways that you can learn is visually, like myself. That's why I show a lot of pictures. It's for me. And I'm going to show a bunch of pictures today. Another way to learn is kinetically, or kind of touching. So I've got some notes. If you all are a kinetic learner, maybe you want to fill out notes. Another way is auditorially, or you listen, you hear. And so I'm going to tell a bunch of stories today. And I ask you, if you have ears to hear or eyes to see, let him hear or let him see. Listen carefully. Are you ready? Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear. Fuzzy Wuzzy had no hair. Fuzzy Wuzzy wasn't fuzzy, was he? Those moron, idiotic politicians in Washington, every single one of them, they're going to drive our country straight in the ground. Wow. You all did a fantastic job with the Valentine's banquet. It was just done with excellence. We sure did appreciate it. Roses are red, violets are blue. Baby, please know, I sure do love chocolate. The Twin Towers in New York were attacked on September 1, 2001. Jesus is coming again. Well, what was it that all of those word pictures had in common? Not really anything at all, except that all of those word pictures were told using words. You just heard poetry and criticism and appreciation and a tongue twister. And by the way, I left this one out. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, and Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. Where's the peck of pickled peppers that Peter Piper picked?
Wow.
Say that time three times fast. You just heard a tongue twister, and you heard some humor turned, poetry humor gone bad, and some history and some prophecy all communicated using words. And when you heard the words, you laughed, or your blood pressure went up, or your mind was engaged, or you felt appreciation, or you felt sorry for my wife for my poor choice of words, or you reminded of the past 9-1-1-1, or you were at look with anticipation toward the future, toward Jesus coming back. I'm going to share a few more stories from James chapter 3, but I want to begin by asking you to think with me about the origin of the beginning of the word, and we have that in John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with, and the was God. The word for word in the Greek is the word logos. We see that word all the time. If you look at the word biology, it's from two Greek words, bios and logos, that word right there. It means a word about or a study about bios, which is life. So biology is the study of life. Geology, which is the word geos, is it's the word for earth. It's a study of the earth. Psychology is the study of the psyche in Greek, the psyche, logos. Whatever study that you want to study, you take that word and you put logos out the end of it, the study of it. I just want to suggest to you that Jesus is the Word. You just put a little period at the end of that. What is it do you want to talk about? What is it in life that you want to talk about? Jesus is the Word. He was there in the beginning. He was with God, and he was God. And then remarkably, John chapter 1, verse 14, the few verses later tells us this. The Word became flesh and walked among us. That is God incarnate. The Word walking in front of us. We read his words written in what color? When we read the words written in red, we are reading the words of the incarnate God. The Word, by the way, we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten Father. He was full of it. What was he full of? He was full of grace and truth. Jesus is the Word. He is the final hour, the final word on all issues related to life. One more of the interesting reminder. One of the most fundamental differences between humans and all other animals is that humans have the ability to speak words. Unless you're baiting the donkey in the Old Testament, what would we do today if we went home? What would you do if Milo spoke up and said, Mom, I'm ready for lunch? You'd give her lunch, and then you'd be jaw-dropped. The use of words is one of the things primarily that sets us apart from all other humans. With that, I want to offer you a few word stories, word pictures that we're going to see today in James chapter 3. Consider with me a champion bred horse running 20, 25, 30 miles an hour. I don't know how fast they run. That horse goes exactly where that jockey wants him to go Because what do we do with that horse? We put a little bit in his mouth. I got pictures of bit. I don't know. I don't even think I realized that. There's the ring on the picture on the horse, and then there's a thing that goes through his mouth. How terribly uncomfortable was that? I guess if I had one of those in my mouth and somebody turned my head that way, I'd probably go that way. I had a little ski boat back when I was hoping I first got married. Bree may have shown that a little prematurely. That wasn't my little boat. I don't have a picture of my little boat. Before we got married, I had a little ski boat, and I was on Lake Bowen, and I didn't know it, but you go into the 26th Bridge and it gets shallow, and so I was just flying around there, whoever's riding out, were you with me? And I hit, it was shallow, and I hit the bottom of the lake with my propeller. And so it bent or broke, I don't remember, one of the three blades on the propeller, and I put the boat in idle, and I walked way back to the dock. That big boat with that big engine, just that little tiny propeller is what drove it. Imagine this ship. I don't know if it's a Carnival cruise. Look how massive that ship is. And do you see there are four little engines there? And with that, those little engines, when those engines turn, there's just a little tiny rudder that turns that entire boat. Does that make you feel comfortable when you get on a cruise ship? I often, at our house, I love to have fires. I'm not good at building them, or I'm okay at building them. But I love to have Jay come over, because every time Jay comes over, what I do is I challenge him. I give him the wettest wood, and I say, Jay, can you build a fire out of this? And he says, sure, I can. And he will do it. He'll take wet wood and he'll build a fire out of it. It just starts, every one of them starts with a little lighter, and it turns into a fire, and you're just amazed about it. Do you remember a few years ago that there was a forest fire in Gatlinburg, Tennessee? It was started by two juveniles being negligent. Go ahead and show that picture, Bree. The cost of that fire was $2 billion in damages. Started by two juveniles who just delinquent. They just lit a fire with some kind of little match. That fire, those fires burned 17,900 acres. The cause was arson by a couple. There were 2,460 buildings destroyed by those fires. There were 14 deaths and at least 190 non-fatal injuries as a result of those fires started by a little striker by a couple of juvenile ones. It started with a small spark. In fact, many of the fires lit off. They spun off because of the embers that went up in the air and blew to a different place. The wind carried those embers. They went to a different place. How about a couple of lighter stories? Have you ever been to SeaWorld and you watch the amazing thing that the killer whales do that they are trained to do? Or have you been to the circus where they bring out the tigers and the elephants? How remarkable it is that people can train and tame those wild animals. One more, or maybe two. In our backyard, there is a small well shaft. But if you were to open that shaft and look down in it, it is completely dry. I had a fellow that came to the house, and came to church here for a while. He said, I think I can dig and find water. I said, please come over. He took his 10-foot sections of PVC pipe with a camera on the end of it and then with a drill on the end of it. He went down and he tried his best to get water to come up from that well. And in the end, there was no water. It was dried up. It was great anticipation. Imagine, though, that he was able to drill. That's not a picture of our backyard. Our well is just a little concrete thing. I took a picture of it this morning, but it wasn't nearly as pretty as that, so I left it out. Imagine that he was able to get some water to bubble up. And we took the bucket and the string and we dropped the rope down, and as the water's bubbled up, the bucket filled up, and we pulled it back to the top and we took our little red Solo cup and we filled it with this fresh water and we took a drink of it, and it was bitter. Imagine how disappointing that would be. Let me give you one more picture. I spend a lot of time walking around our property thinking, what should we do with this property? And I've had ideas like putting horses on it, building rental units, building a water park. You name it, I've thought about it. Imagine I decide, here's what I want to do on this property. I want to plant some fig trees. Y'all know any other fig trees around there? No, I mean, it's got to be a market on its own. I mean, Clayton's going to grow fig trees. Everybody will come buy the figs. And so we plant the fig trees, and the Lord brings the water, and they grow, and they grow, and the harvest time comes up. And when we go out to harvest the figs, guess what we get? Olives?
Amen.
Does a fig tree produce olives? Those are the stories of James chapter 3. I'm going to give you the title of the message. It is Giving Your Words. More on that in just a minute. It's a play on words from the phrase, give your word. Do you remember Jesus talk about giving your word in Matthew chapter 5? He said, but let your yes mean yes, and your mean anything more than that is from the evil one. Clayton, can I trust you? Oh, yes, you can trust me. I'm just honest. I just always do the right thing. You don't have anything to worry about. Clayton, can I trust you? Yes. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. More than that, you're probably chasing a bad rabbit. Jesus' brother, I'm not going to show it, but in James chapter 5, Jesus' brother, we're in James. In chapter 5, he repeats this exact same verse. He had to have heard it from Jesus. Give your word. And leave it at that. Giving your word, add an S to the end of it. It's a play on words, giving your words. More about that in just a minute. So to James chapter 3. Think with me about the idea of giving your words. The words that you give. And I'll remind you of the context of chapter 3. We showed it right there in verse 1. Primarily, the context is those who are aspiring to become teachers. But I would challenge all of us. With the truth of James chapter 3. Here we go. Not many should become teachers, my brothers, because you know we will give a stricter a judgment. Verse 2. For we all stumble in many ways. Here we go. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is mature. Able also to control the whole body. Now, I could just about close in prayer right there, couldn't I? Verse 3. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we direct their whole bodies. You remember that picture, that word picture? May I offer to you point number one? Here's your point. This is an application for you. If you can control your tongue, you can control every area of your life. Those are the verses we just read. It's right there. You control the whole body. If you can tame your tongue, you can control your whole body. You have problems with self-discipline? May I offer you this application? Go home and decide to control your tongue. It's a note to self. It's a reflection of the rest of my life. When I open my mouth and out through my tongue comes words, it is a reflection of the rest of my life. Verse 4. And consider the great big carnival cruise ships. Though they're very large and driven by fierce winds, they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. Might I ask you this question by way of application number 2? Who is the pilot of your words? You may not be the pilot of the whole world, but I will challenge you that you are the pilot of your life. Verse 5. So too, the tongue is a small part of the body. It boasts great things. Consider how small a fire sets ablaze a large forest. Wow, I wonder if they had forest fires back then. Verse 6, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue, a world of unrighteousness, is placed among our members, arms, legs, fingers, toes, ankles, and a tongue. It is placed among our members, oh my goodness, it stains the whole body.
sets the course of life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell.
You're in church, you get to write the word hell as part of the sermon notes.
In the upper left-hand corner is just a little match. And that little match, that little striper, perhaps represents your words and my words. If I'm not also careful about my words, I'm going to set the course of life on fire, and it's set on fire by hell itself. Just somebody say, just like that, just Number three, the tongue, our words, can set the world on fire. There's a lot of great ways to set the world on fire. There's a lot of inspirational, encouraging words. There's a lot of great quotes from a lot of people. Don't forget, your words can set your world on fire. Verse 7, every kind of animal, bird, reptile, and fish is tamed and has been tamed by humankind. Have you ever been to SeaWorld? What a remarkable experience. What a remarkable thing. By the way, have you ever seen a whale train a person? No. You ever seen a person train a whale? It's remarkable, the effect of that. Verse number 8, we can train the killer whales, verse 8, but no one can tame. Is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Number 4, the untamed tongue uses words of evil and poison. Now think about that. Do you know what that says? That says that Clayton's words are either innocent and pure, or they are full of evil and poison. Your words have moral impact. Verse 9, look what happens sometimes. With the tongue we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who were made in God's likeness. Are you a mama bear or a daddy bear? How do you like it when people talk about your children? Not a good thing, is it? When you and I don't control our tongue and we release our tongues and tongue lash out at somebody, do you know who we are cursing? We are cursing one of God's children. Not a good decision. We curse the people who are made in God's likeness. Verse 10. How is it that blessing, go back in verse 10, blessing and cursing come out of the same mouth? Now remember, we're in James chapter 3, verse 1, talking about teachers. How can you stand up here today and say, let me bless you with the truth of God's word, and then lay your Bible down and go home and curse somebody around you? Blessing and cursing come from the same mouth. Don't let it happen. My brothers and sisters, these things should not be this way. The King James said, my brothers, these things ought not so to be. It ought not happen like that. Let me give you number 5. Teachers of the word, which is the context of James 3, simply cannot use words both of blessing and cursing. Cursing God's people, his children, will place you on very, very thin ice. Verse 11, 2 more verses. Does a spring pour out sweet and bitter water from the same opening? Probably not. I'm reminded of the sweet and bitter water from the same opening. I'm reminded of the phrase about you're out in the ocean and there's no water around, or there's water everywhere. Water everywhere and not a drop to drink. Does the spring pour out sweet water and bitter water from the same opening? We're just talking about your mouth. Talk about what comes from out of your mouth. Verse 12, can a fig tree produce olives? my brothers and sisters, or a grapevine produce figs? That's a rhetorical question. What's the answer? Neither can a saltwater spring yield fresh water. Number six, your words demonstrate what you mean. You can't be both speaking the words of God and words of, and I just copied these words out of these verses that we just like. You can't both be speaking words of blessing and at the same time speak words of boasting, unrighteousness, untamed words, restless evil words, deadly poison, and cursing. Out of the same mouth, those same two things cannot come. You may not be a teacher, which is the specific context of James chapter 3, verse 1, but can't you see how these verses, these principles affect every single one of us as a Christian? By the way, if you are a Christian, you are a teacher. By definition, you are a disciple maker. You are an influencer. You are called to be sight and light and salt in the world. People are watching your life. Don't say, well, I'm not teaching something to apply to me. Yeah, you are. You're a disciple maker of Jesus Christ. These truths apply to every one of us. Especially as a teacher of the word, you just don't have that liberty. When somebody comes at you and attacks you or says unkind things to you or stabs you in the back or says something mean to you or something judgmental or something hypocritical or something, it doesn't matter what they say, you simply don't have the liberty of retaliating. Out of the same mouth cannot come words of blessing and cursing. It cannot happen. Clayton, that's a clever title, giving your words. It's a play on words. Because James is basically telling us that all day, every single relationship around you, we give our words to the people around us. It's a clever title, but it wasn't original. For Christmas, I cannot believe that I left it laying on my book stand, on my book table there. Josh Carter brought me a book, and it was titled Giving Your Words. It's a beautiful book, and I'm about a third of the way into it. It was written primarily to parents, any parents? And it specifically addresses the words that you, as parents, communicate to your children. Incredibly challenging and thought-provoking. It discusses, it's really amazing, this couple, older couple now with grown children, it talks about how when they were young and first had children, they sat around and talked about intentionally getting a list of the specific words that they were going to discuss with their children. Wow, what an incredible exercise to take the time ahead of the conversation to consider what are the words that we are going to talk about. Powerful. I would say to you that you and I are like rocks that God has dropped into a pond, and when we are dropped into the pond, what comes out from the sides? Ripples come out from the side, and there's impact of God dropping us in that place, and I would offer to you that your words are what makes the ripples. It's what comes out of our mouths that make the ripples. Maybe you're dropped into a bad home. Maybe you're dropped into a bad job. Maybe you're dropped into a bad neighborhood. Maybe you have a bad boss. Maybe you're in a bad relationship. You are dropped there by the Lord, and the ripples that come out from your life equals to the words that you and I speak. What ripples out from the nucleus of our lives are two things. I think it's the next slide. What we do and what we say. The words are the tools that we've been given by God to change the world around us. Choose them wisely and choose them carefully. And those words come from our tongues. So I want to give you three takeaways. What does a tamed tongue look like? Takeaway number one, a tamed tongue very often says, let me tell you what happens. When somebody comes at you, your spouse, your friend, your neighbor, your boss, when they come at you and they spew out the words, whether those words are mean or unkind or daggers or backbiting or whatever those words are, maybe they come to you and they say, you are an idiot. What words are echoing up the walls right now? You are an idiot. You hear the words echo off the walls? The last words that you heard, you are an idiot. Do you know what words that person who just said that, you know what they're hearing? They are hearing their words in their ears. Do you know what those words are intended to do? They're like a lighter. Those words are intended to come to you and strike a match and start a fire. And whatever words you retaliate with, you're just taking a can of gasoline and you're just dumping it on that fire. Or you can say no. And let it end right there. What does a tame tongue look like? Number one, it very often says nothing at all. Probably what we need to do is to bridle our mouths. Takeaway number two, when it does speak this tongue, a tame tongue carefully chooses its words. I'd like for you to consider these two lists of words. Left side, critical, ugly, greed, trash, hate, trouble, lukewarm, dull. Different set of words on the right hand side, truth, honor, just, pure, lovely, commendable, excellence, and praiseworthy. The question is, which list will I speak from? I don't know if you noticed, if you paid attention, if you remember this verse, but the right-hand side, those words, truth, honor, just, pure, lovely, commendable, excellence, come straight out of Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Paul says, finally, I'm almost to the end, finally, my brothers, and here's that list of words, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any moral excellence, if there's anything praiseworthy, dwell on these things. From that, I will give you takeaway number three. From that verse leads up to takeaway number three. The words spoken by your tongue reflect the things that are dwelling in your mind, which represents what is happening in your heart. You remember that verse, don't you? Jesus is telling a parable. I'll let you go read the whole story, but in Matthew chapter 15, he's telling a parable, and the disciples come to him and they say, we don't understand the parable, and here's what Jesus tells them. Hey guys, what comes out of the mouth comes from heart. That is what defiles a person. May I offer to you some homework to take with you? I put that at the bottom of your notes. Parents, kids, spouses, teachers, students, Christians, everybody. Your homework is to define your home word. Take some intentionality and some practice and some planning. If you're involved in a relationship, I've talked to you a little bit about my relationship at work, some of my relationships at work, and that first one about just not saying anything back, that's hard. I'm just going to say that's really hard. Somebody comes at you and says what they say, it's hard not to say anything at all back. If you're going to say something, choose those words, and then the question is, which words is it, Clayton, that you want to use? To that person who's being mean to you, what is it that you want to communicate back to them? Your homework, I would just offer to this for you as homework. Parents, especially small kids, what are the words What are the words that you want to use in conversation, that you want to use in sentences or paragraphs that you want to have with your children so that your children hear those words? Homework is for you to decide what your home words are. Maybe it's from Philippians 3, maybe it's your own list, maybe it's from a copy of that book called Giving Your Words. I'll close with this statement. I always say it now, whenever I'm preaching at a funeral, I have opportunity to share at a funeral, I'm always aware that one day Clayton Houchins is going to be laying there in a pine box. And somebody is going to get up and they're going to tell stories about Clayton Houchins. And I am keenly reminded the words that come from your tongue will define you. That is the legacy that you and I will leave behind. By the way, one more thought. There are actually at least four very powerful ways of learning. Pictures, I showed pictures. Kinetic, some of you took notes. Stories, I told stories. There's a fourth very, very powerful way of learning, and that is go and practice. Church, let us go and tame our tongues. Let's pray. When I type the sentences up, I always wrestle with whether to say, go tame your tongue, or say, go, Clayton, let's tame our tongues, or I need to tame my tongue. Father, thank you for being present here this morning. Thank you for letting us look at your word. Thank you for challenging every one of us, starting with me. Thank you, Father, for being present. I pray for every one of us. Maybe someone, Father, this morning needs to come to this place of altar, the altar. And they need to recommit their tongues, their mouths, therefore their hearts to you. The song is, I have decided to follow Jesus. Maybe we would modify those words this morning. I have decided to give Jesus my tongue. I have decided to give Jesus my mouth. I have decided to commit to Jesus my words. No turning back. You can just remain seated there. Mark, will you just go ahead and play that song? If we can control our tongues, we can control the rest of our bodies. If we could just master that one thing, maybe God could use our lives in a great way.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided. No turning back, no turning back.
follow you, Jesus, with my life and my hands and my feet and my heart. I'll follow you with my tongue. I challenge folks to come forward and maybe just confess that area of your life. And somebody did. Prayer for all of us is that the sweetness and gratitude in our hearts, the sweetness will gush forth, and from the well springs of gratitude and sweetness in our hearts will gush forth words, sweet words of blessing and praise. How's the church getting along? Just like that. We just tame our tongues, and we speak words of truth and honor and justice and commendableness and excellence and praise and gratitude. God bless the church for it. End of sermon. There's church 240. The kids 247 coming back. Are they gonna come right down here about down front and sing? Aubrey, say no.
Not this one.
Aubrey, you want to come forth and sing a solo for us to close the service? Saran, Mario, right there on the second row, y'all want to come sing a song for us? Kasai, you want to come sing for us? Let me ask you a question. Did you learn a song this morning? Just help the rest of us. What song did you learn? What song did you learn? Huh? I can't hear you. Kids? Y'all know the words to it?
That's the song. It's going to take them a few months to get, okay. But trust me, they're going to knock your socks off when we sing it.
I just thought Mario, he said, I like he knew it. I thought maybe he's going to sing it.
I mean, if he wants to do a solo.
One of these days, Mario or Saran or Kasa or JT will jump up here and they'll grab the mic and he'll sing for us. Will we enjoy that?
Yeah.
Let's let him hear it. Do that, Mario, as long as you want to. You keep showing up with those shoes. He said, do you like my new shoes? I said, yes. I said, what color are they? He said, they're every color. And he's right, they are. Every color. Let's stand together. Thank you all for being here. I love you. I pray for you. I hope you pray for me. Father, you have been awfully good to us, and we are greatly blessed and highly favored. Father, would you allow the words of our mouths to bless you and to bless those around us? Would you cause these words to take root in our hearts whenever, as Jesus said in Matthew 5, blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you for my sake? They used to persecute the forefathers, the prophets, and are probably going to persecute you. Father, would you help us remember that when people come at us with those harsh words, would you fill our souls with words of blessing? Would you use our lives as salt and light? May we just go out and be a bunch of blessers. Just bless the people around us. Use those kind words that we need to use. And when we don't need to say anything, give us self-control not to say anything. Just teach us, Lord, this one thing. And use our lives to change the world. We have been greatly blessed and highly favored. We love you, Father, but we only love you because you loved us first. I pray in Jesus' name. And the church said,